Welcome to the latest episode of the Common Space Show. I'm David Jameson.
And I'm Rhiannon Davis, and today we're joined by Sonja Coquelin from the Living Rent organisation.
This week we'll be discussing Scotland 20 years after the founding of the Scottish Parliament, before we look at a short video of Living Rent's activities and discuss those with Sonja. 20 years on from the founding of the Scottish Parliament, unlike you two, as far as I gather, I was there.
Mm. Yeah. How was that? Was there kind of, you know, parades in the street? Were you out meeting the Queen?
Well, there was. I mean, the Edinburgh City Centre was crowded, though that's not saying much, because I was there the other day.
It's always crowded, yeah.
But yeah, people come out in the street to see all the processions and the royal pageantry and the Queen, you know, processed by in her carriage and so on. The thing I remember is not her, I remember the big carriage. There's this big beautiful carriage came rolling by. And I remember people lining the streets sort of gave a little wave, particularly the older people. Do you know what I mean? A lot of people stared on. Some of that action was going on. I did that back. But people kind of gave a wee cheer and a little polite clap. Some people did.
Were there others turning their back?
Like in the European Parliament.
Yeah.
No, but, and I wonder if it comes from a kind of similar place of symbolic protest. About 20 feet behind the carriage, there were two guys walking along, scooping up the horse shit with big shovels in kind of yellow overalls and all that kind of stuff. And the crowd that was still lingering there watching the carriage move around, as they saw these guys proceeding by, an enormous cheer broke out, and they thrust the shovels into the air. So there was, like, even then there was a slight kind of like disquiet about.
There was more cheer for the workers shoveling the royal shit.
There was a kind of, it was a different time, I suppose, because in 1999 politics was still a bit more kind of optimistic. 1997, New Labour, it was a big New Labour project, the Parliament, and so there was a lot of kind of cheeriness. I always remember there was an old guy, and the TV kind of news made much of it, in central Edinburgh, who was crying and saying, "I've been waiting all my life for this moment, for the Scottish Parliament to be opened." And there were a lot of people saying stuff like that, but I'd never heard them mention the idea of a Scottish Parliament before. There was kind of like an invented tradition type thing going on there, where all of a sudden people really, really wanted a Scottish Parliament. So, I mean, 20 years
later,
on.
Yeah, how does it feel now?
I mean, it's a funny one. I think it's maybe easier to say the things that haven't happened, which is, you know, why there's a sort of mood of like, what is this kind of all about? But It clearly was like a democratic milestone, because without that you couldn't have had the independence referendum. You couldn't have the ascendancy of the SNP. Scotland today would, it's hard to say because, you know, 20 years of difference, but Labour could well still be the predominant party in Scotland all these years later on. So the political scene has obviously changed. Whether Scotland feels like a more empowered society today, given what's going on in the wider country, Brexit, the coronation of another Tory leader and so on, it's kind of hard to say. What's your kind of impression, because you've lived in France, lived in England, lived in Scotland, what's your impression of Scottish society?
I don't know, for me, because I used to live in the south of England, so already kind of like, the more north I was going, the more I started to like it. And then you reach, you know, in a way, Scotland, and I thought, okay, this is, you know, as good as it's going to get. And part of it, yeah, I still feel that in a way, you know, I feel, compared to like what's going on in England, obviously, as a Living Rent member through housing laws, for example, right? I think there's a lot of good things here about also realizing as well that the fees, you know, did not, you know, increase. So this was like, obviously, back then as a student and now as a Living Rent a member, these are two things that I'm like, oh, wow, these are really, really like amazing thing, right? And having obviously this parliament that is able to do that makes you feel, oh, wow, that's incredible. Mm. When I thought I was going to come back to the UK, I was like, okay, where could I go? And I was like, I can't go back to England anymore, because I felt as well in terms of racism or things like that, which obviously the Brexit, you know, did not in a way help. And obviously, I don't know, I think there's ideas as well that like Scotland is necessarily progressive, you know, on all front. Mm-hmm. And I'm a bit like, okay, it is. Clearly, there's a sort of like, there's an element of it. And reading about the history, obviously, of like, you know, working class history of Scotland and Glasgow, there's clearly something there. Mm-hmm. But I think sometimes it's a bit easy to just say, oh yeah, we're just better and we're better. And I'm like, and then you get a lot of like, I don't know, a lot of casual as well, like racism, because usually people think I'm Polish, so that's like the bad migrants apparently. And then they're like, oh, you're French, so you hate the English, all good. And I'm like, okay then. And so there's all this, yeah, a big contradiction, I think, about Scotland.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of went the opposite way to you. So I'm from the north of England, went to university in Brighton, and then went to France, and then and then went to Istanbul. But when I was deciding to come back to the UK, I didn't want to go back to England, and the idea of going to Scotland seemed like a new country. It seemed like they are doing things a bit differently there. They you know, you look at things like Brexit, you look at the racism that kind of has emerged more in England than in Scotland. And that's what drew me to living in Scotland as opposed to England. Whether it is this kind of progressive utopia that some people might paint it out to be is another story, but I think it does feel different.
Oh, definitely.
I sort of enjoy mocking that idea of Scotland being a progressive country, but then I suppose it's easy for me to take for granted a couple of things you mentioned there. Like, the tuition fees thing does matter, right, in terms of access to education, particularly for people from working class backgrounds. The free prescriptions thing, you know what I mean? I mean, that's obviously a progressive thing. And this is what I think that has actually been achieved in 20 years of that parliament. The disappointment is that it's not really broken a lot of new ground. Like, Scotland, it feels different in some ways, but you're still living very much within that kind of post-Thatcher political context, and you're very well aware of it. If there is a difference, it's that the Scottish Parliament has protected Scottish people from some of the regressive sort of legislation. But, you know, is that enough to sort of tie this through? Did you find it was as different as you thought it would be from England?
I mean, it's hard to say. Like, your kind of day-to-day life isn't so different. I mean, I remember the first time I went to get a prescription, and I was like, and I got my card out and said, oh, I'm a student, do I get a discount? And they're like, no, it's free. It's free for everyone. And I was like, wow. So like, things like that, you have a kind of a step back. Yeah. I mean, and I do, you know, Glasgow is a friendly city. It's friendlier than a lot of other cities in the UK, but then you can say that of a lot of northern cities as well. It's not entirely different in that respect. It's hard to say how different my life might be if I was living in England right now, but I do feel more comfortable in Scotland, and I do feel that I may be more connected to people politically in some ways than I do in parts of England at the moment.
I think, and this something that revolves around the Parliament, is people think that they can have a national identity that doesn't draw them into, you know, the kind of ugliness of British nationalism or whatever. The suspicion is that that's actually a creature of devolution rather than an independent Scottish nationhood.
There's a very different kind of judgment if you hang out an English St. George's flag as opposed to you hang out a saltire. They mean quite different things. And if I see an English St. George's flag, you do sort of get connotations around racism, but you don't have that same thing with a saltire, I don't think.
At the same time, I always felt that, and at the time of the opening of the Parliament, much was made that the Parliament was being reopened, having been closed 300 years before, which I always thought was a bit of kind of pageantry and stuff. Because, of course, 300 years before, there wasn't a Parliament, as we would understand it today. It wasn't a democratic body. But it felt at the time that it was a slightly antiquated idea to have a Parliament, even at the time, for that to be the big political development in your country. Because we've had the experiment of parliamentary politics for 100 years now, or at least that's how long the suffrage has been universal. And yet all of the fundamental problems of our society have persisted. I mean, is it worth us discussing experimenting in more direct forms of democracy? I'm thinking in particular about a citizens' assembly, which is one of the policies that has been raised by Nicola Sturgeon in the Scottish Parliament, which is not direct democracy in the way it's sometimes discussed, but it's kind of experimental. I mean, do you see that as like an interesting step forward?
Yeah, I mean, I see it as a step forward, certainly. It's experimenting with something new. It's worked in other places in Ireland. It has had a positive effect from what I can see. how you pick, I think it's 120 people that they want to pick, how you pick 120 people that represent Scotland, I don't know, and I don't know what that would look like. But yeah, why not try it? But I don't know what subjects it would look at and what subjects it should look at. I mean, should it be looking at things, you know, around housing? Should it be looking at things that kind of bigger picture? Should it be looking at more specific, I don't know, controversies?
Does that feel like a dynamic idea to take 120 people, presumably more or less at random, stick them in a room and ask them to debate the future of Scottish society?
I mean, if this is going to be democratic, I mean, I would hope that we can do better than that. because back home it's a bit the same. There's all this idea, right, that Macron was doing as well around this sort of like, yeah, we'll come and speak and have those.
Macron's, yes, this is interesting. Macron's doing this across France where he's convening lots of local assemblies. But that's like a response to the Gilets Jaunes, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And obviously he's not welcome in many places where he goes, right? But still, yeah, I think it's important to like get back this idea that like people can, should have a say, right? Like even though we live in this representative democracy and we elect these people who are supposed to represent us and know better, we realize that obviously, regardless of parliament or no parliament, they don't know better, right? So I think there's a big argument to see, yeah, any sort of like ways we can have those more general assemblies. But the question is, again, how, what can they do? Is 120 people really, you know, the solution? Yeah, as you say, how do they get selected, and how they're going to be used, right, as well? Because, you know, the way Macron as well is using it a lot of the time, you know, you just see half of it, and obviously, like, the media does a very good job to show the support that he's got in all these kind of, like, sometimes local places as well. So, again, if it's just used as a propaganda to say, look, there you go, you've got your citizen, you know, assembly, what else do you want? Because I think sometimes there's a bit of that here. People are like, what else do you want? Like, when last time we asked Nicola Sturgeon about her, about the eviction, right, and we wanted to put this winter break to ban evictions during the winter months because, yeah, people here are dying on the street, right, in the winter. And the answer was like, why? We've got a great new tenancy agreement. And so it's like, okay, but that's just not good enough, right? And I think for me, there's a lot of things as well about, sure, there's more progressive aspect of like a lot, as you said, right, education, health and housing, which every time when I think about England, I'm like, oh, your fees are still legal. And now they're, so it's kind of coming down, for example, this like banning of like fees, like agency fees and things like that in England. But I'm still like, okay, but that doesn't mean that here it's like that, what, there's no housing crisis? Right, like what is it that like homelessness has risen again by like what, 3% or something like that? And so the answer to say, yeah, but look, we've got better, like I think there's always this kind of like, yeah, but we're better than Westminster. And I'm like, sure, but that doesn't say a lot. Yeah, like I mean about how good, you know, like it should be. So yeah, sure, citizens assembly, but then again, that I think anything that comes as well a bit more top down, you know, it's not a solution as well in the long run. So what, you get your lottery ticket, oh, you've been selected to like have your go into, like, you know, democracy.
I think the comparison between the Gilets Jaunes and Macron's assemblies is an interesting one because, yeah, one of those is organised from the top down and it's a state project. And the other is, because the Gilets Jaunes also have mass assemblies where they debate things and they discuss things, but they're doing it off their own backs. And there's the funny kind of dynamic there is we often think of the most potent democratic forms are the most sort of inclusive ones. Inclusive has become a big word under devolution. But actually, the Gilets Jaunes assemblies are more democratic because they're more self-selected. You know what I mean? Because it's people who've come out onto the streets with a relatively similar common goal, which is wealth redistribution, challenging the political class, whatever. Their conversations are going to be more directed and more fruitful than a powerful person saying, can all the middle class people from this town come and agree with me that things are actually okay?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I think that's the real test for any experiment in direct democracy. I mean, I don't want to just say this experiment with the citizens' assemblies or whatever, it's going to be a waste of time. But if it is just given a very controlled paradigm of what it can discuss, it's always going to be inferior to something that a social movement could do, for example, the types of conversations that it could have. We'll maybe get on to discuss, for example, some of the things that tenants debate inside Living Rent. I would be very interested to let people in the Scottish Parliament see the things that tenants are discussing between themselves, you know, as the problems that they face.
Well, I think on that, shall we watch a little video about what Living Rent is and learn more about how you operate as a tenants union?
Mm-hmm. Renting in Scotland today comes with many challenges. The deficit in social housing, soaring rents, and landlords charging illegal fees all leads to people being priced out of their neighbourhoods. In this precarious arena, many renters put up with substandard conditions for fear of losing their homes. But there is an alternative. Living Rent is Scotland's tenants union.
Hi, I'm Sonja. I'm from Living Rent, Scotland Tenants Union. We're here to talk to tenants in the area about their renting situation.
No. Building tenant power.
First, what is a tenants union and how does it work?
Well, that's a good question. Again, you would join a trade union in your workplace if you're aware of trade unions and aware of obviously the victories they've had for people and improving their own conditions from the workplace. Mm. Now, we're seeing landlords and letting agents and the people who own property basically are getting more and more power every year, every month. They lobby government, they lobby local authorities. They've got a lot of power in their own side. So to redress that power, we need a union that tackles housing, and this is why we need a tenants union as a whole to start fighting back against this unbalance of power. And the only way to do that is to organise and fight back as tenants collectively.
Often landlords and letting agents that we face haven't used direct collective action. They don't know what's hit them.
We adopt 5 different roles, all with different remits to make sure that the landlord or corporate letting agent doesn't stray from our demands. It's a way of making sure that demands are clear, but also empowering the tenant who might feel often harassed by the letting agent or landlord. When they feel that they've got the strength of 4 other people behind them, that's an incredible feeling to have. We had today at the AGM a testimony from Annie, who we've supported in her fight. She was completely leading the workshop where we did a role play on how to use this strategy. So that's just sort of testament to the empowerment element of that strategy.
Hi, my name's Inas and I'm going to be alongside Living Rent, just knocking on people's doors in Govan to tell them about the work our union has been doing. Demanding on people's behalf that letting agents and landlords give back the illegal fees that they've been charging tenants for too long.
I really like the idea of community resistance and like being able to, like, I think it's really easy, especially among youth, to think that we're just really isolated and alone and that we don't have any power.
When we go and chap up neighbourhoods, chap up doors, like as many organisations would, mm-hmm. and ask people there themselves in their own neighbourhood what they feel is the biggest issues affecting their housing issues, mm-hmm. and affecting their community as a whole. We are more about listening to people and hearing their grievances and seeing what we can do to actually try and help them out of that situation or try and improve that situation.
So hearing the doorbell and saying, "Hi, I'm from Living Rent, Scotland Tenants Union. I'd like to speak with people in the block that are like tenants." Usually somebody buzz you in, right? And then you go in. Half of the door there might not be somebody. Some of them might be busy, like you don't know.
We as a union rely on a bit more empowerment for members themselves so they can actually realise the power they've got and what they can do organising. And it doesn't have to be the union, and it isn't the union saying, right, you have to organise this way, you have to do this. No, this is about showing our members and educating them what their actual rights are, what they can do to improve it, map out what their situation is, who the people are of influence in that situation, and what they can practically do to get from that position of having no power to having power.
A lot of tenants in this area that are unhappy with the amount they're having to pay.
Yeah, it's just insane.
Yeah.
It's just, I don't know, I'm spending like 30% of my...
I guess the first thing is, like, remind them that it's okay to be angry. They're allowed to be angry. They're allowed to expect decent housing. Then it's about showing that they're not alone and that we can solve it, and we have solved it, and so that there is solutions. So it's like people will often feel powerless or like really alone, and it's just trying to show that no, we can do that together, and we have done it.
I think one of the really good things is that before we ever go into things, we always do a practice run, and I find that really useful. Can sometimes lack a bit in confidence, but if you've actually gone through things and worked out what you're going to do if the landlord says this, or if she says that, or if what if she does that. So we think through it, and that kind of training I think is really useful. It's been helpful, and I've built a lot of confidence as a result of it.
What does Living Rent ultimately want to turn into in Scotland? If Living Rent could be somewhere in 5 years' time, where would you like it to be?
I want to see us become the biggest, most powerful tenants union in the country. I want to see houses built because Living Rent has put much, much pressure on the government and local authorities. I want to see near enough every social letting tenant in the city, any tenant in the city, any tenant across the country join Living Rent and have that protection of knowing that there's a militant union out there that has got your back and will not take no for an answer from a landlord or a letting agent.
Okay, so that video was filmed last autumn when I went out door knocking with Sonja and Gubbin and I came along to the AGM. Mm-hmm. What's been happening with Living Rent since that video?
A lot has obviously been happening, so we are growing a lot, the fastest growing union in the country. We've managed to build mainly our neighbourhood branches. Now we have obviously the citywide campaign with the Serco evictions, and I think that's a big development since the last AGM, is our growth in numbers and in strength as well.
Tell us what's going on with the campaign against evictions.
So, obviously, since Serco lost their contract and Amirs is taking over, Amirs is refusing to take on the properties, which means that therefore those 300 tenants and households are going to just be evicted. So, yeah, we launched our campaign in a way as Living Rent last week. We decided to go on the offensive. So we went to both Serco's office and Amirs' office in Glasgow, both time with the symbolic action of we're going to lock you out. And so we had this big action around bringing your padlocks. The fact that like now Mears want to be meeting with us, I think shows that like, yeah, we've managed to like bring back a bit like the focus. Because I think last year there was a big, like everybody in Glasgow was kind of like, yeah, behind it and was going to do something. And then of course, then it dies out a bit. And again, from your question, right, about why a union makes a difference, well, yeah, we're not a campaign. We don't just like, okay, there's something. It's like, no, we are still there on the ground and so always able, whatever the problem is, to also kind of quickly organize around it. And through, obviously, our training and everything, we've got a specific way to organize. So I think that's also another reason why we want to build a union so that if in 5 years something happened, in 2 years, we're able to like call, well, a campaign will come and, you know, die out. And now, yeah, the No Eviction campaigns is doing a lot of good work as well in terms of being the first point of contact and going to speak to the asylum seekers and refugees that are being served eviction notices. And so I think together, working together, we are able to like, yeah, take on, yeah, I think, I don't know where this
and obviously the No Evictions campaign is a broad campaign, but as you say, it makes a big difference when you have a permanent organisation that's always there and always has the capacity to respond. So there have been two demonstrations now on the Saturday and the Thursday last week, both of which were extremely large. And from the point of view of groups like Serco and Mears must have seemed to have come out of nowhere. But even that capacity didn't exist the last time this crisis came around last year. It was almost like it emerged at the click of the finger. I mean, I know you never see all the boring organisation that goes on behind that, but it was just a sudden response, you know.
I think in some ways it might be useful for people to actually go back and explain, for people that aren't aware at all of what's happening, how this kind of issue came to pass and how you got involved from the very beginning.
Because, yes, so last summer I think, yeah, it was just an article in a newspaper, I think, that started it all. So it was like, okay, Serco is going to change the locks, right? And that created, yeah, as you said, popular kind of resistance. But then we thought, okay, as a union, then what are we going to do, right, to fight this? Because, I mean, Serco is a multinational company with a lot.
And this is 300 refugees are under threat. And there's
asylum seekers.
Sorry. Oh, well.
Tenants.
But this is interesting as well, that for you it's not just a refugee rights issue or whatever, everyone's a tenant and it's and that's the basis on which you organise people, but people who for various reasons are deemed that they are asylum claims
failed,
not being met or whatever. But there was a threat that the locks would be changed on 300 people, and this, so the campaign first started out last July. And then, because of the immediate pressure that the union and others applied, they looked like they withdrew from that threat, and now it's sort of re-emerged.
We had a kind of massive week of action that was like every day. Yeah, there was like demos there was demo at Serco's offices like quite a bit, but then also there was like, we went to talk to housing association, right, asking them to make a stand and be like, what are you going to do? Your properties, you're renting, right, Serco is using you, because Serco, right, is a company that will use private landlords and housing association to then host asylum seekers and refugees. So we went to say, what are you going to take a stand? And so we had this delivery of letters, which then we could expose all the good housing association and the not so good housing association. After that and all this mobilization, they were like, okay, like this is not going to happen, and then it went to court, right, and things like that. And so now, since then, of course, it's been, they've come back and say, well, now it's happening, but it's happening at a much faster rate than it should have happened, because back then I think the idea was to evict 10 people a week, which you know, is still a lot. Now they're like, okay, we need to do it faster because we need to, you know, give this contract to Mears in September, and therefore now it's 30 people a week. So there's kind of a bit of an escalation of what they're doing, and it's quite, yeah, if they do get away with it, it's going to be quite scary because these people are literally going to be in the streets. Like, there was no, who is going to take them on? Nobody wants to take them on. They're saying it's not our fault, it's the Home Office, the City Council. I mean, they're all blaming each other. And at the end, what we're saying is like, well, we don't care who's, you know, who's fault or who takes them on, but you cannot evict and put these people in the street, considering, as we said a bit before, like the homelessness crisis that is already present, right, in Glasgow.
And have you been speaking to any of them directly?
No, that's not, yeah, so that thing would be more like the no eviction people in this campaign, because it's a more, yeah, you need to build as well, like, trust and confidence. Well, we as a union, we said, hey, it's true, right, it's not really the thing that we do, because they're better organization, right, like a more unity center, things like that, they're a better place to actually deal with our ash they have. That's their thing. We decided as well this time that, of course, we provide support and we want to be in touch, but we're going to go and do a bit like something else.
And I mean, it's quite an important thing, not just in Glasgow but UK wide, because this method of just changing the locks on people, as particularly on refugees, but actually for all kinds of people, is an important way in which landlords evict tenants. So if there's effective resistance to a lock changing campaign, that could have a major impact across the country.
Yeah, they come and they change your locks, and it's quite like, you can't be in the property when this happened. So let's say you go to the corner shop, you come back, can't get in. There's something quite very cruel, I think, as well about it, because what do you do with your belongings as well, or things like that. But yeah, it's happening in, yeah, different contexts for sure.
Just remind people what type of organisation Living Rent is, because a lot of people who are involved in politics will be aware of sort of street protest movements, campaigning type organisations, you know, like Greenpeace, or, you know, there's a lot of them, and they'll be aware of political parties. They might not quite understand what the difference is between that and a sort of grassroots tenants union. What's the difference in the kind of organisational model that you have?
So I guess, yeah, Living Rent is Scotland Tenants Union, not a campaign, as many people still call us, even though we started as such. And I think the main reason why is where we wanted to operate as a union is because we don't just face a single issue, right? Like the housing crisis, if you want to tackle it, it's not just going to be like kind of one issue about like a better tenancy agreement or rent controls. It has to be on all fronts. And also we want to build something. We want to build the biggest tenants union in this country to be able to have a long term, so that, you know, in 20 years' time, that like that organization is still here, what campaigns they come and go, right? It's a very as well activistic kind of like culture, you know, and then once the issue is gone, then that's it, you're gone. What we want to build, as you say, a deep root organizing to go into neighborhoods, to seek to build neighborhood power and to have a project that's lasting for decades.
And there's a big difference as well, isn't there, where you want tenants to empower themselves mm-hmm. through that activity rather than be led towards activity.
Yes, I think, for example, a lot of people come with questions, right, and they want advice. Okay, we tried to do that a bit, but usually we just signpost it as well to other organization, because we're not here just to offer advice, we're not here to be a charity, to lead a service. It's not all, you join the union, you come, get your deposit back, and then, you know, that's it, right? We want people to feel their own power, and that's, I think, very, very important. Well, if we can, we could take your case on, we could fight it for you, win it, but then what do you get through that? Like, the empowerment is what is key, and that's what other organizations are not able to give if you fight for other people on their behalf. We want people to do their own fight, we want people to get their own knowledge, to learn by themselves, and only through realizing your own power, then you're able as well to see the bigger project that we're building.
And does that come with the kind of the training that I came along and saw at the AGM? I mean, how do you pass that power and how do you empower people?
Well, it's not, it's a lot of, a lot of training that we do regularly. So we'll have a lot of, like, we have a program, we're developing a program for the next year that has both a sort of kind of like 10 weeks vision of like training that we need, but also education, right? So the training will be more about the skills that you need. So for example, being able to go door knocking. Every time you go door knocking, we don't ask people to have experience, but we always provide a sort of training. And then by doing things with people, that's how you also build their confidence. So it could be the march on the landlord. That's one of my little favorite, when we enact, mm-hmm. you know, us going to see a landlord and rehearse a little bit to give us again that confidence once you're facing the real landlords. And then on the other side as well, also educating ourselves. So at the moment, for example, we're doing a reading room around the financialization of housing. And that's for us also to be able to tackle, right, the more difficult kind of like question, but also like, the training that you need on the ground. So that happens, just regularly, depending a bit what's going on.
Mm. What's been the reaction of landlords to when tenants are self-organized and stuff like that? I mean, some of the stuff that I find most interesting from Living Rent social media, it's not even the big stuff. I like it when it's stuff like the giant mushrooms growing out of people's walls and stuff like that. Because a lot of that stuff goes on in Glasgow. Mm. The housing stock's really damp and stuff like that. People think that's a big problem, but it does cause, particularly when it's families and stuff, you know, tenants are really frightened by it might be making them ill and stuff like that. How do landlords respond when, you know, the tenant phones up and they say they're a member of the union now and they want the rep there and that kind of stuff? What kind of responses do you get?
Well, we don't usually tell them everything, right? But it's true that recently with the Seize the Fees campaign, it got to a point where it was great because the tenant just emailed the agency and said, look, I'm a Living Rent member. And they said, all right, we'll give you the money back. Like, with no question asked. But I think a lot is that, landlords use this this power, right, that they have to intimidate you and isolate you. And that's why people always feel you're scared, right, to do anything. So that, when you shift it, they're just like, they don't know what to do. Like, literally, because you show up. If it's a landlord, so like, this mushroom case, we did go to her house, right? And like, very fancy house. And I'm like, knocking on the door, hi, it's Living Rent, you're not paying your deposit. And they're like, whoa, like, off guard. And it's like, well, you're registered, right? Your address is kind of like, we know where you live and we are going to come and get what's ours, right? Mm-hmm. When you go to agencies, it's also the same, because they're just used to kind of like, be like, no, our manager's not here. No one, you're like, look, we're not going to leave. And then suddenly you realize that very quickly when you like actually challenge what they do, and we do it obviously in a very organized way. So I think, they're very off guard, and then we just get things like very quickly because they're just not used to that. I remember dropping like dead mice on a, on a, this housing association, because the guy would be like, oh yeah, but I wouldn't mind living with mice, you know? And I was like, all right, do you want this one? And then he was just like, oh, and then we left it dead mice, you know, in the office. So yeah, there's something quite enjoyable for once to be on this other side and to have this power and then get something out of it and win. Because I think that's the main thing, is that we win. Mm-hmm. You know, if we did all of that for no reason. But no, it actually does make the good results.
It's interesting when the police turn up, because often it's to situations where landlords have broken the law.
Oh yeah.
And they phone the police, mm-hmm. and the police turn up and talk to people who aren't breaking the law. And mm-hmm. it's a very interesting dynamic to kind of force that. I always enjoy that.
Mm-hmm.
But Living Rent and the wider No Evictions campaign are obviously gearing up for this. Mm-hmm. I mean, you presumably want people to get involved.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think, yeah, the No Eviction campaign will be the people that are going to do a bit more this work of like being there with the people affected, but also kind of, yeah, reading about the letters, you know, helping people with that. And maybe if people are willing to then resist them physically if needed by any means necessary, as we keep saying. Mm-hmm. And then for us as Living Room, we say, okay, well then at the same time that this happened, we'll also be, you know, going after Serco and Mia's and their business interest and really trying together, therefore, to make a stand. So, yes, I would say that people should really get involved in this, because, as we say, like, usually they start as well a lot of things through refugees and migrants to then spread,
mm-hmm.
right? So in terms of the law change, in mm-hmm. terms of the intimidation or whatever, if they get away, well, then, yeah, it's going to spread as a kind of like normal practice. So I really think it's important to make a stand. And I feel as well, it could send, as you said, this happened in the UK all the time, everywhere, and no one is doing anything but us, in a way, in Glasgow. So I feel that if we could as well fight this and win this, then, of course, what could happen like elsewhere, people might also be, well, actually, we're not going to let that happen here. And that would be obviously very problematic for the Home Office.
Great. So if people want to get involved, they should join the Living Rent Tenants Union. You're mm-hmm. you're kind of coordinating some aspects of the action, and people can sort of take it there.
Yes, we're all over Facebook, social media is probably where we're going to be. So get in touch, and then we do our best to answer quickly, considering that we are a volunteer run organisation. So sometimes it's a little bit difficult, but yeah.
Brilliant. Well,
thanks very much, Sonja. Join us again for a forthcoming edition of the Common Space Show. Hope you've involved this one and the pilot show that was out a couple of weeks ago. If you have any ideas for who you want to see on the show, what you want to see discussed, please don't hesitate to get in touch.
Thanks for watching.